Beijing is one of the wonders of the world and the grand imperial capital of the Qin and Yuan dynasties. During the Ming and Qing, it developed into an incomparable masterpiece of urban design. As one of the greatest existing medieval cities in the world, it bears the heavy weight of memories gone by. The new government had just been established, and so many pressing tasks awaited. The burden of developing the capital fell to the Beijing Urban Planning Committee. Liang Secheng, the committee's vice director, and the newly appointed director of enterprise planning, Chen Zhenxiang, made the decision to draw from lessons that Western cities had learned over half a century of development and create a long-term plan for the thousand-year-old city. They submitted a proposal titled Suggestions for the Location of the Administrative Center of the Central People's Government. The main idea of this plan was to place the center of the people's government, the construction of which was about to commence, outside the old city.
Liang 先生他主张的是 把行政中心放在西郊。 他认为这个行政中心放在西郊啊，是牵涉一个全局的问题。实际上是北京用什么理念来规划？
Liu Xiaoxia was in the third graduating class and became secretary of the General Party branch in 1956. In the 80s, he became the director of Beijing's City Planning Department.
那么他放在西郊呢，有一个很重要的作用呢。
With the old city kept entirely in its original state, other areas would be divided into zones with different functions. Each area would have residential neighborhoods and services, and traffic would be kept to a minimum. The population in the city center would be naturally dispersed.
他认为城市就像一个人有机体的细胞，每一个细胞都健全了，这个城市就健全。那么他的 概念呢，它的理论呢，就说城市规划的最高的目的是人民安居乐业。The
Liangchen Plan was finished in 1950. To the newly established government, city planning was a completely new subject. The new China was in its infancy, and the new leadership had just taken its place in the imperial capital after more than 10 years of war and turmoil. But politicians and scholars had different thoughts about how the city should be planned. On the eve of the founding of the nation, it was already decided that Beijing would become reoriented around production instead of consumption in order to consolidate the new people's government. The People's Daily pointed out that in the semi-feudal, semi-colonial old China, the cities where the ruling class lived were mostly cities of. They owed their existence and prosperity to the exploitation of workers and the countryside. We absolutely cannot allow this to continue after we enter the cities. To eradicate these problems, we have to restore and develop the productive forces in a planned and methodological way. This line of reasoning was very much in line with the views of the newly arrived teams of Soviet experts.
那么后来就是苏联专家来了，那么就越来越有些事情就比较它复杂的事情。In
the first years of the new nation, the two big ideological camps of the world were at each other's throats. For the benefit of the new government, China made the decision to lean to one side, the Soviets, in foreign policy.
但是学习苏联这个口号提了，而我们大家都是，这对美国也反感了，再加上抗美援朝啊，那更反感了，那直接给我们打了，而且威胁我们呢，那我们都是全心全意的学习苏联，而且苏联专家来讲话，可是以前都没听见过有这样说法。 你比如说，就是说，无产阶级的首都必须有强大的工人阶级。你说这个，我们就是想不出来是无产阶级首都。中国的首都就是首都嘛，哎，他都有这样的话。那当时我们的革命热情很高啊，听了这个就觉得，差不多要热血沸腾了。
At the end of 1949, the Soviet experts put forth their plans for Beijing, which recommended copying the experience of Moscow and locating the administrative center in the heart of the capital, with Tiananmen Square at its core. Beijing would be built into a large industrial city with a strong working class as its primary population.
当时的问题在什么地方呢？因为我决策层吧，我们讲决策层呢，对这个这一类的问题啊，太没有接触了，这是第一点啊。第二点呢，当时的后来的形势啊，也太快，急转直下，接到抗美援朝了等等这样子，没有多少在研究讨论的余地。
说当时没有这个决策就像那打仗不需要征求意见，我要往这儿打，也没有那个机会啊，你说是不是？那过去打了好几十年呢，打仗那儿还有那个是决策民主啊，这个关心的还是要经济建设搞上去，还要抗美援朝是诸如此类，所以这个不太符合当时观念。
On the eve of the founding of the nation, it seemed as though there was a scholarly debate over how to plan the city. In fact, there was never any real doubt what the outcome would be.
所以后来这个做北京城市规划的依据是什么？两条，苏联专家的意见，领导的意见。
As people were reveling in their newly found peace, the old imperial city was to be remolded into a new capital where the people would become their own masters. I will just give two numbers. In the year after Beijing was liberated, 349,000 tons of trash accumulated during the Ming and Qing dynasties was removed from the city.And 61,000 tons of dung was taken away. These are small things, but also two great miracles. They are two great little things that we can all be proud of. But gradually, anything that stood in the way of creating a capital oriented around production faced the threat of elimination.Symbols of the feudal imperial rule, like city walls and towers, and structures that hampered the widening of roads, such as towers, temples, and archways, all came under consideration. Even the Forbidden City, which some said just sits there empty in the middle of Beijing, impeding the movement of pedestrians and cars, came under question.
然后这个要拆，那个会一会儿要拆。那就是整天就是像，我说都打遭遇战。你可以避免，闭着眼睛想一想，这么多的首都，这么多的单位，现在空房子给它容纳下来。好比良心说，有时候路不要太直，这个车子就走得可以减少速度。他这个林学子哪有路不直的好嘛？这四川人那种的，这是怎么变这么奇观？这简直不可理解，简直就在前头有时候就争论的或者一些什么。
那么梁先生当时就说了一句话，说这个车现代城市要限制车的速度，不能让它。开得很太快，这是危险的。现代城市也要限制车的速度，尤其。于是这时候群众来信就说了，梁思成要限制我们这个社会主义建设的速度，是给你上纲到这样。所以那个时候我觉得，整个社会，整个包括知识界，能够理解要保护古代文化，这种人太少。所以我觉得，在解放初期， 可是解放以前，他们就有这种观念，这是很不容易。他这个观念不但是在中国是很不容易，在全世界也是很超前的。
The brutality old buildings are subject to fills my heart with incomparable sorrow. Demolishing a city tower is like digging out a piece of my own flesh, and peeling off part of the outer city walls is like peeling off a layer of my own skin.
所以讲每拆一个什么东西，相当挖我一个肉，这样都是这种这样的。你们现在看不到，因为现在北京也没有什么东西好拆了。现在拆就是拆四合院了，就是拆什么呢？
If there's no objective standard for preserving the cultural essence of the world, then much of it will surely be obliterated amid future power transitions or the ebb and flow of tastes and fashions. It would be a great sorrow, both culturally and aesthetically, if an ancient Oriental city were to completely lose its architectural characteristics. What were the architectural characteristics of the ancient Oriental city that Liang Sicheng had in mind? If a city center can preserve the glory of its ancient buildings, the shade trees of its alleyways, the halls of its old government offices, or the beautiful archways, it will be much more magnificent and suitable for the Chinese identity than building small and ugly fountains and monuments with cement in a foreign style. We should study the stone carvings of the Han, the pillars of the Song and Tang, the gateways of the Ming and Qing, and various pavilions, dams, screen walls, stone bridges, and adopt them in modern design with discretion and new architectural verve. This is the double tower of the Qingzhou Temple at Sidan, constructed in the Jin period. Liang thought up a modern layout for it. The city walls of Smolensk have been called the necklace of Russia. They were damaged during the Great War, but the Soviet people spared no effort in reconstructing them. The city walls of Beijing are without a doubt the necklace of China, indeed great as to deserve to be called the necklace of the world. Liang Sicheng envisioned a large park on the city walls that had encircled Beijing for more than 10 centuries. The tops of the city walls were 10 meters wide on average. In his vision, they would have flower beds with cloves and roses. Hundreds of thousands of people could enjoy the coolness there in the summer evenings. It would be one of the world's most special parks, an elevated park surrounding the city with a length of 39.75 kilometers. In fact, many ancient city walls of the past have been destroyed. London, Paris, and Rome all demolished their city walls after the victory of their revolutions. Liang Sicheng wanted to keep this masterpiece, which still stood in the 1950s.
一些老干部，包括老人家，看到城墙都想到那是封建的土围子。解放军为了解放这一城市，死了多少人？今天你还要保护它，这么一个感情的话，那你简直是，现在想起就非常可笑了。但那时候就是这么一个认识。
所以当时拆城墙的时候，老百姓也没有是多大意见。为什么呢？老百姓也并不认为这个城墙是个艺术品。就像我们现在中国的游客到埃及去旅游，一看见这个金字塔都很失望。这后来去看了那神庙呢，都很佩服得很。看了金字塔很失望，为什么？说这个金字塔。经常很粗糙，有东西啊，嗯，所以这是个观念，到现在那么中国人还是这个观念，
但是问题复杂就复杂了，所以毛这个梁先爷感觉到困惑了，就是说，共产党又这么爱护这个文物，你看打仗的时候还专门让你调查这个文物要保护，所以共产党这些领导也觉得我们不是不爱护，我打仗还是，但是。 这就是一个认识问题。对什么是故宫呢，当然就不能打，对不对？但是有些东西妨碍性的话就应当拆。梁先生认为这个是它是个整体，你不能拆，一拆就完了，对，整体就没有了，你光孤零零的保卫故宫有什么用？
A part of the old city wall was discovered near the corner gate of Dongbianmen in 2000 during the reconstruction of the old city. The district government treated it as a lost treasure and painstakingly began restoration work to make it into a park, hoping to replenish some of the splendor of the ancient city walls. In 2004, the city wall of Yongdingmen was rebuilt, 50 years after it had been demolished. In 1951, Liang wrote an essay for New Observer magazine titled Beijing, an Incomparable Masterpiece. In 1952, Min Huiyin started a column in New Observer, Our Capital, which introduced Beijing to New China and the value of its thousand-year history. After his plan to preserve the whole old city of Beijing came to nothing, Liang attempted a backup plan, which was to reflect on the national character of architectural plans for new buildings. At the time, this was in line both with the new democratic ideals and Stalin's requirement that Soviet buildings should have national characteristics. Liang and Lin had both been fascinated with studying ancient architecture and now began to counsel each other on political matters under the new regime. When Liang visited the Soviet Union, Lin wrote a letter. What I could report to you about my recent study is, apart from the important political essays, I've also read four Soviet biographic novels, all of which recount the stories of true heroes.
就是因为梁先过去那套呢，就是都是西方的理论，对吧？那么解放之后，我们学习马列主义，这个学习政治。梁先觉得，哎，自己的所长的、所喜欢的，又符合了这个马列主义理论，实际上找到了一个思想武器。
In a lecture at the Central Science Committee, Liang spoke passionately, insisting that architecture has national characteristics and that Chinese architecture has a long tradition and unique styles. He shared his findings from decades of architectural studies with the audience. Liang described two architectural blueprints. Recommendation on a possible method that can be used when studying how to adapt ancient Chinese relics and national culture. However, the currents of architectural thought were soon to change abruptly. In 1953, Stalin passed away, and the neoclassical architectural style that the Soviet leader had advocated came under criticism. China's architects saw which way the wind was blowing and changed accordingly. The Journal of Architecture published a number of articles critical of large roofs. The People's Daily published an editorial saying that one important source of waste was formalism, as well as the ideas of revivalism promoted by certain architects. They take the palaces and temples of the feudal era as examples to follow and rely on the most expensive materials to create lavishly ornamented buildings. This not only wastes large amounts of money, but also impedes functionality. A movement to criticize large roofs started. Buildings that were criticized as having large roofs included the Friendship Hotel, the Dianmen Government Residential House,
and a number of office buildings under construction for several national ministries. As the criticism of revivalism started, the two wings of this office building were already finished, and the roof for the main building was about to be installed. Due to the criticism, it had to be finished with its hat taken off. What we see here today is the building of the Chinese Academy of Sciences without a traditional roof. Liang, the man who had been studying old buildings his whole life, naturally bore the criticism.
那个岗上得很高的了，上得很高的了，反动的，就是除了政治上是要求进步的，也有方面的思想是反动的什么什么。另外写的要组织的写批判文章，我也写了。As
this great campaign of criticism began, Liang and Lin were both hospitalized due to illness.
他们两个人住连房间。 然后通一个门可以通的，又做看梁先生，我就问他说你在隔壁看看，就你搁隔壁去，我不知道什么回事，你隔壁看，宁辉，宁辉第一句话讲，他说我们浪富浪富啊，就是难兄难弟嘛，是吧？他就是浪富浪富啊，他说我们现在，这样的先生。我记得林先生有一次跟我说，他说，梁先生啊。 他是一个什么人？他是一个搞学问的人，他的东西都在他的学问里头。可是现在要否定他的学问，要否定他研究的学问，他还剩什么了呢？他就什么都没有了。 我看他的时候，多少还是很凄惨的，因为他如果是没有建筑思想批判。 他的精神还能维持，他的一切动力是他一个信念跟他的学术跟他的精神，他是这么的一个劲，他能到的时候他完全，他也可能知道一些事情，知道一些学术思想，对吗？在这，他感觉到无能为力了。Critical
movements of even larger scale were underway. A group of writers convened at the Summer Palace to criticize Liang Shicheng from a professional angle, especially his belief that the Communist Party did not understand architecture. In 1955, an article entitled Criticizing the Phenomenon of Waste in Architecture was published in People's Daily, only a few days before Lin Huiyin's death. In January 1955, Lin's daughter, who had just given birth, went to visit her mother in the hospital.
一看我妈那个脸色，我知道不对了，知道她要走了。当时我就想，在这个以前呢，我没有感觉到这一点，因为我妈是个活蹦活跳的人，你知道，她虽然病得很重啊，但她自己不把自己当病人，别人也不把她当病人。
Sometimes I sat anywhere, pretending to be resting and talking lazily. But in reality, I was trying to get my breath back in secret and could hardly hear a word what other people were saying. When there was company, and I did enjoy myself, very likely I was too tired afterward and suffered terribly. But if I let others know about this, probably I would have no company and next to no life at all in future.
可是那个医院呢，他是肺病，你知道，医院说是我那个婴儿是无论如何不许进医院的，所以说什么医院也不同意。
Huiyin was getting close to the end. On the 1st of April, 1955, she left her loved ones and her beautiful ancient city.
各个连环，永打不开。生是个劫，又是个劫。死的实在，一朵云彩。长条旅程，永在中途。生是串脚步，泥般沉重。死是尽头，不再辛苦。 一曲西涧，日夜流水，生奔逝，永在离别，死只一回，他是安慰。Liang
designed a tombstone for his wife. The image on the stone was taken from the sketch she had made for the monument to the people's heroes. After her death, Liang continued to be criticized, even on his sickbed, for neoclassicism. A few dozens of critical essays had already been compiled, but the large-scale public criticism suddenly came to a halt.
那么后来为什么没有公开批判呢？当时据后来评，彭真说彭真网上也找个梁子，也跟呢这样子一样，就是当时一个胡适，一个胡风，他说这两个再加一个梁漱溟，还有一个梁思成，要二胡二梁这栋传出来之后，都好像变成反动派了，所以梁心跟他们还不一样。
Liang's supposed neoclassicism was finally diagnosed as a professional issue and not a political error. At the CPPCC in early 1956, Liang read out his self-criticism on traditional roofs.
我长期的在建筑问题上同党和政府的领导同志争辩着，僵持着。 我竟然认为这个领导六亿人民翻了身的党不能领导建筑。我以专家权威的姿态，不为自以为是，而且自高自大。这一切都肇源于我的阶级出身和由他而来的个人英雄主义和个人自由主义。感谢党的英明正确领导，及时地揭露了建筑中的偏向，指出了我的理论错误。 及时地遏制了这股歪风，否则，它将继续造成更大的浪费，把工人农民辛勤劳动所积累起来的资金去填进形式主义的无底洞。It
was after this meeting that Liang Sicheng solemnly submitted his application to join the party. A year ago, as I was congratulating my daughter on her honorably joining the party, she said she didn't just want to. Communist Party, but the daughter of a member of the Communist Party. One day, I believe the party will allow me to fulfill the wish of my lovely daughter, comrade.
Because I loved, also loved this. There's a contrast. The previous government, now how it is, he knows very well. So he loved this country, loved this party. 很拥护这个中国共产党，他眼看着把一个很贫穷落后，都给人家快瓜分的，变成一个是中国人都站立起来了，所以他很佩服的。所以当时也有人说，也有人说，连批评梁先生政治上还不怎么样，但当时北京市委就讲他是爱国主义的。
他非常爱北京城，但是他，我是觉得是这样子，他更爱这个国家。这个国家能够中国发生那么一个大的变化，他觉得这个是非常根本的。
所以当然他也有矛盾了，他不能理解怎么他这么爱这个党为什么要这么批判他，他有点，所以这也是他的这个赤子之心。我父亲这个人没有城府，他很他这个他就有的他的心顶啊，有的时候就像小孩子一样，他很少去，他没有什么世故，没什么城府。
After Lin Huiyin passed away, it was arranged that Liang Sicheng would recuperate from his illness in a quiet corner of the summer palace. That year, he sent his daughter a letter on her birthday. Darling, I call you this again since it is a special day, especially this year. 26 years ago, I got to know you and hear your voice for the first time. After I got home from the hospital, I found a picture of you when you were around 20 days old. Mummy hugged you in the picture, and on the back of it, there is a poem written by her, a round, round face. I remember last year when you called home on this day and Mummy answered. She had forgotten it at the time, but remembered it later, something that made her ashamed for several days. Sicheng became more socially active during the late 50s.
就是说，政治上是好的，所以两个人这个社会地位不断的升。但是他的学术，他的这一主张呢，不断的受到批判，受到挫折。所以两人后来灰心，有点灰心丧气。反正以后我就热衷于社会工作了。他社会工作就政治活动了，社会活动了。
哎，那就是，看1958、1959年以后，就当时他这个老是这个出国啊，参观访问呢、啊，我就想他怎么好像有点，好像觉得他有点浮起来了，怎么不那么踏实了？好像不那么实在，都不够埋头苦干了吧？那有过这种想法，后来想想你也很难怪他，因为既然那是复古主义，他怎么研究古建筑呢？
后来他说实在的，对批评对他这个精神上面还是很有损害。后来我们就说他是。到戏里是蜻蜓点水，当时《大字报》批评他，实际上他就是这个，还是受了些损害，搞业务啊就没有信心的，所以后来他讲课也不多了。你说他那个是以前讲那么多课，那是充满了这个，热情了。
In 1959, Liang Sicheng joined the Chinese Communist Party. Not long before that, the Great Leap Forward movement got underway amid extravagant fanfare. As the absurdity reached its nadir, a glimmer of hope flickered in 1962. The Central Committee held a meeting about science in Guangzhou and corrected leftist mistakes. Intellectuals felt that the atmosphere had become somewhat more relaxed.
这个大会上面呢，周恩来做了，实际上讲了对知识分子的政策。后来大家还不太满意，最后陈毅同志就听出来了，就是不愿意这个直上这些知识分子的帽子。 后来陈毅就宣布脱帽。周恩来讲的是工人阶级之术。
Liang Secheng's professional articles began to appear in newspapers and magazines again.
所以叫空气稍微松动一点，一个学者仍然想到他的学术。
In 1961, Liang Secheng climbed a mountain in Guilin, where he wrote a poem. Leading the climb up the mountain, though I am shy to claim youth, just worried about staying behind, so I strive ahead for my life. On the 22nd of January, 1962, Liang's daughter received a letter he sent from Zhonghua. Bing, I've been in Zhonghua for 3 days. It's facing a lake, and a swimmer would be able to dive into the lake from the window. I'm not sure I told you or not, but in Rongxian, I found a building from the late Ming Dynasty, built in the oldest constructivist style. The negatives have been developed, and I have the survey and mapping drafts ready. I have been combining rest with work here for 3 days already. In its seventh issue of 1962, the journal Architectural Studies published another article by Liang on ancient buildings, in which he gave expression to his long-standing passion for ancient architecture. I haven't practiced my old profession for many years, and as I am painting, my vision is blurry and my hands are trembling. But I am unable to restrain myself and I work with utmost joy. During that spring, he began working again on the book he had loved so much through his life, Building Standards. The Department of Architecture at Tsinghua University sent three young students to help him. It was at this time that a young activist in the department, Lin Zhu, came into Liang's life. This kind-hearted and strong woman kept Liang company for the last 10 years of his life.
Luckily, 那么幸亏梁子炎有一个学术情绪在这里头，所以银装发誓在过的那么多年弄完了，还是文化大革命就来了。而且所以宁珠的功劳很大，就是幸亏有宁珠的，他把它藏起来，但是就没有得到没有损失，包括梁子炎其他作用。
The warmer political atmosphere of the early 1960s vanished in an instant. Classes at Tsinghua University stopped, and the architectural department building was ransacked. The employees at the department were sent to the countryside for agricultural training. The department no longer needed for Liang Secheng. When the architectural teaching he loved so much was being torn to shreds, he was already an old man on the brink of death. January 9th, 1972, Liang Secheng passed away. Liang Secheng's father, Liang Qichao, as a politician and a scholar, did not in passing on all of his ideals to later generations. His hope for his children was that they would inherit culture from the past and act as the builders of the future. Never would he have predicted the course to be followed by the lives of his children, who were so imbued with architectural and artist dreams for which they paid a heavy price. Secheng's death, the long closed door between China and the United States opened again. John and Wilma Fairbank, who had lost contact with their intimate friends more than 22 years earlier, came back to China. After having been separated for so long, John and Wilma were excited to meet the old friends whom they used to have tea with. But their hosts were already long gone.
Some 2 months after our wedding, we met Liang Secheng and his wife, Lin Weiye.
Our closest friends in China, or elsewhere for that matter, were Liang Secheng and his wife, Lin Weiyin, two people who combined the Chinese and the Anglo-Saxon cultural traditions.
我说你是人间的四月天，笑响点亮四面风。不知木构的可能性到了什么程度，我佩服极了。佩服见到这大师的时代里不知名的。在一段较短的时间内，蹦出神奇的，如同两个人透彻的了解。一句话打倒你心里，使得你理智和情感全觉得。来实地塔所得的唯一唐代木构殿宇，不但是国内古建筑之第一瑰宝。
什么时候，又什么时候，心才真能懂得这时间的距离，山河的年岁。